I want to introduce Alyssa Worsham, who is a recent graduate of the Master's of Environmental Management program at Western Colorado University, and she is also an environmental planner at an engineering and consulting firm in the Pacific Northwest. And Dagny Signorelli, who is a graduate student in Master's of Science in Ecology program at Western Colorado University, and is researching historical fire regimes in the Powderhorn Wilderness. And in this session, some of you may have joined the previous session, which was focused on the research that they've been working on. And this session, they're going to be talking about prescribed fire and wilderness workshop that they had. And they're going to talk about the process that they provide some insight behind the process used to encourage discussion among wilderness professionals during the wilderness and fire management workshop that they put on. So with that, I will turn it over to Alyssa and Dagny. Thanks very much for joining us today.
Cool. And we are hoping that most of the people here did attend the previous session, because a lot of this presentation will make a lot more sense if you did. But super brief recap is that we conducted research over the past year using surveys and interviews of both fire and wilderness managers from around the country to understand how fire is managed in wilderness currently, what the ideal conditions are, how to address the gaps between ideal conditions and current conditions, and specifically focusing on the role of prescribed fire use in wilderness. And so with that being said, we'll get started. So we, like I said, we conducted this research last year, is primarily through the spring and the summer of last year. And then in the winter, in December, we hosted a workshop at Western Colorado University. And really the purpose was to ground truth the research results that we had heard from people from all over the country and bring people together in a room from both the wilderness side of management and the fire side of management to talk about these subjects. Because throughout our research, we heard things from wilderness managers, for example, that they were frustrated that fire managers weren't including them at certain points in fire management processes. And then conversely, we heard from fire managers that they were frustrated that some wilderness managers were too rigid on how they interpreted certain policies and guidelines and stuff like that. And so we really wanted to get both wilderness and fire managers in a room together and talk about how should fire be managed in wilderness moving forward? What is the role of prescribed fire? And just see what kind of interesting discussions came up during that. So like I said, it was hosted in December of last year. We had 21 participants who attended, including several of our interviewee subjects. And we also had a variety of different job titles, again, from both wilderness and fire, including specialists, also line officers and program managers and indigenous practitioners. So we tried to get a really diverse group of different managers in that room. And the overarching goal was to prepare an interagency white paper, which is a paper that generally presents a stance on a certain topic, especially a complex topic like prescribed fire in wilderness, backed up by research and background information, and also that presents opportunities to further the use of prescribed fire in wilderness where appropriate. Again, coming from the backgrounds of both wilderness people, fire people, tribal people as well. So that was the goal there. And we'd like to start today, because we found it to be such an interesting process during our workshop to help people get to know one another and see where they're coming from. We're going to start today with a poll using the app Mentimeter. And so what you'll do is you'll either on your phone or your laptop, you will go to menti.com and enter this code. And Kim just pasted it in the chat as well. And we're just going to get some super quick info from all of you on like where you're coming from. And then we'll show you the people that we brought together for the workshop in a similar vein. So we'll head over to Menti. And you should see the first question on your phone or on your computer, whatever device you're using. And you just enter in for the first question, what is your favorite wilderness area? And as folks enter it in, it'll pop up on the screen. And I should say that the size of the words indicates that more people have answered it. So we have some fans out there of the Powderhorn Wilderness in Colorado and the Boundary Waters. So that's pretty cool. Too many good ones. We got the Bob on there a couple times. Cool. Okay, let's head to the second question. What agency or organization do you represent? Well, we have a lot of Forest Service people. We've seen that throughout our research and also in our workshop, which is really interesting. Also, some BLM presence there as well. Okay, question number three. How many years of professional experience do you have? Well, that's super interesting because all of our research was primarily focused on people who had more than 15 years of experience. And it's really cool to be in a virtual room with folks who are just now getting into this awesome field. Okay, next question. Have you been involved with fire suppression in wilderness? All right, we've got more yeses than nos, but it's relatively even, so that's cool. Next one. Have you been involved with prescribed fire in wilderness? This definitely reflects what we have heard throughout our research. Prescribed fire is a lot more rare in wilderness, and we'd love to talk to you five special people who have worked in prescribed fire. And last question, do you support prescribed fire use in wilderness? And we've left an other category because we know that this can bring up a lot of stuff for some people. And so we'll be happy to talk about that in questions. Okay. Well, it sounds like we're gonna have eight really interesting questions from folks at the end of this presentation. We'd love to hear what other means to you, but it's really cool to see majority support and actually no opposition, which is really interesting. So thanks for participating in that. It's again, just interesting to see where people are coming from, especially in a training workshop like this. We will switch back to the presentation and kind of go through those similar demographics and the selection process for workshop participants that we had. So we contacted a lot of different people for this workshop. For the interviews and surveys in the research, it was primarily self-selected. We sent out the survey to many different newsletters and stuff like that and relied on snowball sampling, which means that we ask people, once you take the survey, send it to your coworkers if they're involved in fire and wilderness management. And so that was a mostly self-selected. For the workshop, I'm sorry, we were very intentional with getting a variety of different agency participation or organizations like nonprofits, academia, tribes, as well as trying to get a diverse selection of job titles. So people that were program managers of like fuels and fire in certain regions, and additionally people who are working on the ground in the field out in wilderness areas doing fire or wilderness management. And so Once we contacted people and we heard no, we asked for them to recommend other people to us who had either really interesting experiences with fire and wilderness management or had similar job titles to those who couldn't come. And in total, we had 21 people say yes and come to our workshop. And those folks, we had participate in the same exercise on Mentimeter that you just did, primarily Forest Service folks, though we had a relatively even spread for the rest of the categories here, except for Fish and Wildlife Service. We tried pretty hard to get participation from Fish and Wildlife during both research and the workshops because they actually do a lot of fire management in fish and wildlife wilderness areas, and even are doing prescribed fire in certain areas as well. However, we could not seem to get a lot of participation. And as one of the four major or the four main wilderness management agencies, that was a little bit of a bummer. Like I said, we were going for a diverse range here. Forest Service is the most, which we saw today as well. And again, kind of makes sense given how much wilderness is managed by the Forest Service, especially in the lower 48. Also, like I said, we primarily had folks with more than 15 years of experience, and they were bringing really, really rich case studies from the different places that they had worked throughout the country. And a majority of folks had been involved with prescribed fire and wilderness, which I think is almost exactly opposite of that survey we just saw for the folks on the meeting today, that it was a majority of folks with that had not had participated in prescribed fire and wilderness. And then lastly, a little interesting thought exercise we asked our participants was to think about the different words that come to mind when you think of wilderness and then fire management, just to see kind of where people were coming from. For wilderness, you see that restraint is the largest word. So that was used most often. Also things like untrammeled, complex shows up in both of these here. It's just interesting to see what comes up. Safety and risk are both in the fire one, politics and controversy too. So people had a lot of different kind of like preconceived notions coming into the workshop, I think, based on like their experiences. And it really was an interesting experience to have people sit down and talk to one another, those who had been involved in fire for maybe their whole career versus involved in wilderness for their whole career. And so we underwent a very intentional process that was led by Dr. Melanie Armstrong. She has a lot of experience in facilitation, and she was a key person in developing the structure of this workshop. So the first day was creating shared understandings among workshop participants. So during the first day, we presented the results of our research, as many of you may have seen in the previous presentation here. We also did a policy review to talk about things like, well, what's actually in the Wilderness Act? How have different agencies interpreted that? And what is their specific policy guidance that they have in their documents? What recent legislation has, how that has affected wilderness and fire management? And then we also heard a lot of really interesting case studies from around the country where fire is being managed in really innovative ways, including use of prescribed fire. And then additionally, two projects that are undergoing review right now that specifically are trying to put fire on the ground in wilderness areas and kind of the different things that they were bumping up against in those processes. So that was the first day, really creating those understandings among each other. So that in the second day, we could head into discussion groups, which were focused on the areas we identified in our research as barriers to wilderness fire management. So that included administrative considerations, plans and policies, implementation and of plans and policies, and also public communication. So folks self-identified into those groups based on what they're most interested in, and then identified specific priority actions within that subject. We moved on from there and brought everyone back to a big group to identify of all of these issues for these very specific topics, what rose to the top and were actions and opportunities for change that everyone in the group could get behind and support. And so that kind of incited an iterative revision process, which leads into the white paper that presents all of these ideas, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So as I said, we first presented our research, and then we did a bit of a policy review. So we talked about the Wilderness Act and what's in it. Section 2C lists all the wilderness qualities, language like untrammeled by man, wilderness areas are protected and managed to preserve natural conditions affected primarily by the forces of nature, opportunities for solitude, primitive and unconfined recreation. All of those really rich, meaningful phrases end up informing the different policies and guidelines as interpreted by the agencies. Things like no temporary roads, use of motor vehicles, motorized equipment or motorboats, landing aircraft, except as necessary to meet minimum requirements. That's section 4C. That's obviously going to inform things like minimum requirement design guidelines or analysis framework, I guess now. And then 4D1, so that's that the exception that such measures may be taken as necessary in the control of fire, insects, and disease, and then how that again pops up in policies for different agencies, being able to have that exception for fire management that's listed in the Wilderness Act. And then wilderness enabling legislation. Since the original act in 1964, Congress has added over 700 new areas to the wilderness preservation system. And in some of these, the legislation that creates these wilderness areas, there are specific fire management provisions for certain areas. And these different provisions can include things like creating pre-suppression activities or designating what types of strategies can or cannot be used before a fire versus during a fire and stuff like that. And then differing agency policies and guidelines. We went through a pretty exhaustive list of the different policies that the Forest Service, the Fish and Wildlife Service, the BLM, and the Park Service use as their guiding principles. As we mentioned in our research, we generally found, or we heard from managers, that the Forest Service had the strictest interpretation of the Wilderness Act for all management activities, which includes both fire suppression and prescribed fire. It is because it's a product of how their policies are written, and the Forest Service also stands alone as opposed to the other three management agencies, which are all under the Department of Interior. And there is some pretty noticeable different language that is used by the agencies there when describing how the objectives for fire management and specific objectives for prescribed fire as well. An interesting paper that compiles all this policy is from Allness. It's Allness 2017. I can send that info in the chat later. If you're really interested in policy, it's a good one that will just spell out all the differences for the four agencies. And then lastly, recent legislation in the bipartisan infrastructure law. A lot of money went to both the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Interior for doing fire management, including proactive management, like prescribed fire. And then we saw in the Inflation Reduction Act in 2022, similarly, more appropriations for fire management. However, there was a specific restriction in there that none of the funds available could be used for activities conducted in wilderness or wilderness study areas. And so that was pretty interesting to see in federal legislation because it obviously controls how that money can be used then by the agencies. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Dagny, and she'll go through some of the different case study presentations that we heard from the participants at the workshop.
Awesome. So yeah, we were lucky to have a bunch of really interesting and innovative case study presentations at the workshop. We had Yosemite National Park, the Superior National Forest, and the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness. Also from Cultural Fire, we had the Taos Pueblo Tribe from New Mexico and the Yurok Tribe from Northern California. And then current projects were the Powerhorn Wilderness in Colorado and then the South Warner Wilderness in Southern California. All right, so for Yosemite National Park, Well, in general, with the case study presentations, we wanted to know what managers use besides bolt suppression. And so, of course, we were interested in prescribed fire, but prescribed fire isn't a very common practice in wilderness areas, as you all know. So there are other approaches that people use, managers use in their wilderness areas. And Yosemite National Park decides an elevational line above which every year they'll let the lightning ignited fires burn. And this includes in all of the wilderness areas in Yosemite. This has been successful in restoring the Illilouette Basin wilderness through managed wildfires. It helped restore that watershed. This picture is just of the forest conversion change simulated from basically 1990 and then the simulations in 2070 to 2100. And then you just see, those lower elevation woodlands moving up in elevational gradients because of climate change. And then we also heard about Yosemite mapping out fire return intervals and knowing what part of the parks are departed from those fire return intervals. So a few different interesting things from that national park. And then the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness implemented the largest, most successful wilderness prescribed fire program that we saw. The left picture is of Treatment Unit 54. Basically, the managers of the Boundary Waters determined an 80 to 100 year fire rotation in the 1970s by cycling through units, and they burn almost all the units within the last 20 years. And they also talked about treating the blowdown that happened in the July 5th, 1999 blowdown event, which was just a massive blowdown event in the Boundary Waters. I'm sure some of you are familiar with it. It was a safety concern. The fuel buildup was a safety concern. So they treated a lot of that blowdown with prescribed fire. And then something else that was important to point out for the Boundary Waters is that there's all this new research coming out about how often the indigenous population up there burned in the past. And so this graph here, it's probably hard to see, but what's important is just those fire scar years. There's fire scars and there's also like peel scars that are just like the evidence of indigenous use of that land. And then you can see as soon as 1900 hits, like I talked about in the first presentation today, there's no more fire scars. And then we also heard about the Taos Pueblo tribe in New Mexico, which owns the Blue Lake Tribal Wilderness. This is 1,640 acres. And the fire management crew there is working to burn parts of the Blue Lake Tribal Wilderness. And basically, like the most left picture there is the current condition. The left picture is the current conditions, which you can see is like high fuel buildup. It might be hard to see, but there's a bunch of fuel on the ground and tree densities that are high. And then the picture on the right is those aspen stands with the one or two or three conifers in there, just depicting a more open forested landscape. And so Taos Pueblo is working on burning parts of that wilderness right now. And then the Yurok tribe in Northern California is really interesting. They're part of a partnership with the Nature Conservancy to create the Cultural Fire Management Council. And a couple of really cool things that come from that are these training exchanges. So we got a question in one of the other wilderness presentations we did, like, okay, it's great that, indigenous fire was used in the past, but how do we do that? How do managers know how to apply it in that way? And that's why the training exchange program is so cool, is because indigenous people from tribes, and namely the Yurok tribe, who have extensive experiences in fire and can help train agency folks from all over the country and actually all over the world on how to apply fire. And so that's really interesting because that can help with the, you know, wilderness and naturalness and not using mechanized equipment. And then also the Cultural Fire Management Council talked about the just showing the benefits, you know, the benefits, the post-fire benefits of vegetation and stuff. So you can see there's some forbs there that pop up after a fire. All right, and so we heard about two current projects, the first being the Powderhorn Wilderness, which I am relatively familiar with. There was a spruce beetle infestation from 2013 and from 2014 spruce budworm, and this created a high mortality of Engelmann spruce. And so you can see in that picture, I know the first one's kind of shaded, but all that was green conifers that are now dead. And the idea is to mimic small scale disturbance and improve timber stand resiliency by putting prescribed fire in the wilderness. And basically, so yeah, I just called Brian Stevens. He's the kind of the manager of this project. Well, he is the manager of this project. And he just had the environmental assessment signed and is developing a burn plan right now. And the first area to treat would be about 2,100 acres. And I called him actually because of the question we got from the last presentation about the use of chainsaws for these prescribed burns in wilderness. And his initial plan does not use chainsaws at all. And they're using natural features as control lines. So I thought that was something you might want to know. And then the South Warner Wilderness Fire Restoration Project is in Southern California. Totaling about 70,000 acres, and it's a forest health project that promotes forest resilience from the severity of wildfire, insect infestation and diseases using adaptive management activities such as low intensity fire, primitive hand tools, and will utilize and reflect the traditional cultural management practices of indigenous peoples of the area. And so both of these current projects aren't using chainsaws, at least in their initial plans. And I think the idea is to impact the landscape a lot less than they would have to if they had to go in and suppress these fires in the event of a wildfire. Cool. So key takeaways from the case study. First, that fear is an impediment and complexity increases with time. And we see this with fuels. We see the fear with the risk aversion and stuff of people. And then two is agency personnel may be unaware of success stories. And three, science is the key to demonstrating the need for prescribed fire in wilderness. And four, neither the Wilderness Act nor agency policies explicitly prevent prescribed fire in wilderness. And this is something important that Alyssa will talk about in the white paper. And five, that what is the relationship between tribal treaty rights and burning rights?
Okay, and so moving on from those case study presentations, which were meant to highlight success stories and stuff that we saw were otherwise potentially not highlighted by agencies and in the media, like we often see the horror stories, not the success stories. We then kind of used all the information to then inform the discussion groups that we broke people out in. Like I said, it was based on the barriers we identified in our research. So that's administrative decisions, including funding, staffing, and training, public communication, like outreach and education, plans and policies, so NEPA, as well as resource management planning, and however that looks differently for all four agencies, and then implementation and practices of these plans and policies, so looking at specific management strategies. And so folks at the workshop self-selected into these four groups, and then were tasked with identifying an issue statement related to their topic and coming up with priority actions for addressing these barriers. And after that, we brought all of the different groups back together and then had people regroup by their agency. So for example, like in administrative decisions, we had folks from Park Service, tribes, and Forest Service. And then after the issue statements and actions had been developed, we brought people back together and had the Forest Service folks all sit together and talk about their different focus groups and how that looks specific to their agency. And then after that, we brought everyone back together again and talked about all of the actions that were brought forward and whether or not we could identify ones that had general consensus among the group first and really start from there to revise them or find them and come up with things that everybody from all of these diverse backgrounds really believe to be important priority actions to bring forward. And so one of the ways that we gauge support and then built consensus was using a couple of different voting methods. So you'll see in the pictures there, we show posters being hung on the wall. So that's what the groups, their deliverable to the whole group was to come up with different priority actions, which are listed there as bullet points. They're pretty small, related to their main topic. So for example, this one you can see increased education about Wilderness Act and agency policy. Like Dagny mentioned, prescribed fire is not prohibited by either one of those. And this specific one was coming from the public communication group as a priority action. And then the first method of consensus building we had was sticker voting. So everyone went around and had different colored stickers, and the items that had the most stickers there listed were ones that were brought to the group, again, as ones that already had some pretty common support among folks. And then after that, using those ones that were most common, we wrote them all into a document, which was the basis of our white paper, and then used this five-finger voting method to really drill down on specific action items. So if anyone voted a 4 or a 5 on a particular item that was going into the white paper, it was blocked and a 5 was blocked, but we were not moving forward in the process on any item that received a 4 or 5 without first talking to folks. And so it was a really interesting exercise to go through the list of these actions and have people hold up a hand with whatever number they wanted. And for folks with a 4, we talked it through, asked if it changed their position to a 3 or below. If it did, we moved forward with that. And if it didn't, we removed it from our list of items. And by the end of the workshop, there were no 4s and 5s on any of the actions that we had listed. And so those all they formed the draft white paper, which we then took back to basically we created it at the workshop live on the computer. And then once the workshop was over and we had all of those ones that had been voted on and been supported, the Center for Public Lands, which is housed at Western Colorado University, and me and Dagny refined those different opportunities for action in the white paper and sent it out again to all of the workshop participants and asked for a final vote. In general, the white paper includes these actions, but it also includes a lot of the background information that we talked about at the workshop. And as we mentioned in the previous presentation, one of the things that came up time and time again that didn't fit neatly into our research necessarily was just this idea of Indigenous cultural burning and what wilderness areas looked like before they received a designation and how fire played a really important role in both Indigenous communities and in plant communities. And that was such a key topic that was woven throughout the white paper. And really comes forward through the different opportunities for action. And so let's see, the audience for this paper is higher up agency administrators and managers and decision makers. We are hoping that through this white paper, we can illustrate the point or the importance of cultural burning and its role in prescribed fire use in wilderness areas and beyond, really. And then also specific to prescribed fire in wilderness, really, what should next steps be now that we've done this research in combination with other research that Dagny had reviewed early in our last presentation about changing climate conditions and stuff like that, trying to more proactively prepare ourselves for future wildfire seasons and stuff like that. So there were 8 categories total that we developed in the white paper, and each one of them had several specific opportunities for action. Again, that's what folks voted on at the workshop. So the first general category was acknowledging Indigenous cultural burning in wilderness. And this included promoting recognition of Indigenous cultural burning as a component of historical fire regimes in wilderness, also integrating traditional ecological knowledge with scientific literature, policy language, and public messaging about fire. The second category was about messaging and the relationship between wilderness and fire. So this one had specific actions, including educating agency leaders, special interest groups, and the general public about the relationship between wilderness and prescribed burning. This includes messaging about prescribed fire as a management option that can be appropriate to maintain wilderness character and can also return wilderness ecosystems to healthier, more resilient conditions. The third category was about expanding and formalizing collaboration. So this included measures such as increasing cooperation, collaboration, and communication among federal land management agencies, tribes, local and state governments, and nonprofits to maximize opportunities for prescribed fire and wilderness where appropriate. Also to develop multi-agency agreements based on established partnerships to share resources for implementation of prescribed fire. So really creating a more collaborative environment, not only within the government, but also between the federal government and other organizations and agencies. The fourth category was to initiate proactive and far-reaching engagement. So this was more focused on the public, revising timeframes for public engagement to incorporate more and earlier involvement with agency partners regarding plans for prescribed fire. It also included building trust by establishing shared desired outcomes. This was also the case with, or also applies to consultation with tribes as well, expanding that engagement beforehand instead of showing up with a plan already decided instead of developing one together that would be more widely supported and therefore less likely to be blocked. The fifth category was increased access to training. This involved developing training curriculums and experiential learning opportunities focused on prescribed fire and wilderness in order to increase understanding of historical fire regimes, cultural fire, fire ecology, and fire effects. This also included increasing MRDG, but now MRAF and MRA training, and involving the Carhartt Center in the newly established prescribed fire training centers. There is one that, because of recent legislation, will be happening in the West. And so we'd like to see collaboration there. And additionally, seeking tribal participation for training specific to cultural burning practices. So like Dagny had mentioned, just the importance of reaching out to tribal partners who have been doing cultural fire for the last several centuries, and how can that be applied to wilderness areas in order to uphold wilderness qualities. The sixth category, creating comprehensive and consistent interagency messaging or policy and messaging. These actions were directed towards the Wilderness Policy Council and the Wilderness Steering Committee, putting the ball in their court to craft comprehensive interagency messaging to promote consistent Wilderness Act interpretations regarding fire management. also inviting tribal participation on these federal committees, which include members from each of the four land management agencies. And then lastly, revising Forest Service guidance documents to be more consistent with policies for the agencies and the DOI, which have more flexible fire management, specifically prescribed fire management strategies. The seventh one, building leadership for updated policies. This was directed at agency leaders to establish intent among them to encourage constructive risk-taking and support of wilderness prescribed fire. Again, perceived risk was such a major part of our research and what was a barrier to all fire management, especially prescribed fires. And then also the action to circulate a letter of support among agency leaders and staff regarding wilderness prescribed fire. Lastly, the eighth category there addresses fire management more broadly, inside and outside of wilderness. There are a lot of budgetary, administrative, and legislative barriers that end up affecting wildland fire management everywhere, including within wilderness areas. And so this category included actions such as developing a dedicated fire workforce, staffed with full-time employees and supported by stable funding allocations to increase capacity for prescribed fire planning and implementation. Because as we've seen in legislation in recent years, it only lasts for a couple of years and then it has to be decided upon again. And when things are up in the air like that, it's really hard to establish a dedicated workforce. And again, that includes for fire management, both inside and outside of wilderness. And then lastly, some next steps moving forward. We are hoping to finalize and distribute the white paper that we just talked about soon. It has currently held up in a Forest Service policy review. Our research was through the Aldo Leopold Wilderness Research Institute, which is part of the Rocky Mountain Research Station. So there's just some loose ends we have to tie up there. And then after that, we will be promoting it through media outlets, again, hoping to get it in front of some pretty top agency folks. And then kind of concurrently, we're also finalizing our research manuscript related to the presentation that we did before this. And we're hoping to publish that this year. So. With that, we would like to take any questions. Thank you so much. Okay, Kai said, I worked on the Gunnison Ranger District as the Wilderness Areas Manager. Strategy to implement fuels and prescribe fire outside the southern boundary of the West Elk Wilderness in order to allow fire and wilderness managers wider margins and comfort to allow lightning ignited fire to play out inside the wilderness boundaries. Is that a strategy your study and workshop considered and or is being applied and planned at other units? That was definitely something that was mentioned during the research that we did is as a suggestion for addressing barriers is doing active management on the boundaries of wilderness areas to exactly what you said there, increase the amount of decision-making space that you have inside of a wilderness area to let fire play a natural role. In some areas, either due to geography or fuel conditions, it still is potential that if a lightning fire ignited in there, things would burn too hot and too fast and escape the wilderness and suppression would still be used. But it was definitely mentioned several times in the research as a way to let fire play a role inside the wilderness while keeping active management on the boundaries of wilderness. Question was, do you have any plans to do a large scale, 1,000 plus respondents survey of the public on their beliefs and or opinions on this topic? I don't think we have plans to do that. The researcher Sarah McCaffrey has done some really interesting research on public perception of fire. It's not specific to wilderness areas. And so I would suggest reading some of the stuff that she's done, but it would be interesting to see what a majority or a large part of the population thinks about it, because we did focus specifically on land managers, specifically wilderness and fire managers. So
I just want to give a big thanks to Alyssa and Dagny for both the sessions that they presented today and really interesting research, and then the findings from the workshop as well.